Well, good evening and welcome, and thank you for accepting the invitation to join community events hosted by the Solidarity Building Initiative here at McCormick. I'm Jia Johnson, and I'm the program director for SBI.
And I am Grace Okerson, a graduate intern with SBI. If you're new to McCormick, throughout this year, McCormick offers a wide and diverse range of community events that center on issues of social concern and faith.
And so the SBI team has been working diligently since last year to curate a 9-month community curriculum to host our public-facing programs. Our community event series is designed to shed light and offer insights on creating a better world for people and communities impacted by the criminal legal system.
As we've been planning our 2021 series, it's been important to us to invite formerly incarcerated people to be part of the planning process. They are closest to the problem and therefore closest to identifying the solutions. We cannot do this work apart from the critical expertise of formerly incarcerated people. This year, we invited Mia Walker and Avalon Betts Gatson to join SBI as community advisors, partnering with us to shape, organize, and plan our community events.
And so during one of our planning sessions, Mia Walker, a prison abolitionist and criminal justice advocate, asked, "How do we plan to shed light on the unique experiences of formerly incarcerated women?" And so we took Mia's question to heart. So throughout this series, we will highlight the experiences and work of formerly incarcerated women. And we want to expand that. And so women who have been incarcerated will not only be a part of the discussion, shaping the work and doing the work with us, but they will also be facilitating and leading some of our sessions. Avalon will be back. Avalon will be with us to moderate our next public ed series on March 4th, which will be entitled Beyond Bars, Women, Wisdom, and Holistic Healing.
On Journey, our theme for this year, takes off with a 3-month spring community course on healing and equipping individuals to be community healers and justice makers. Then we travel through a 3-month summer community course around historical memory and justice that concludes with a 3-month autumn course that will look at reparations and radical imagination.
And so today we are kicking off our spring community course with a conversation, as you know, with Johari. And the title of our conversation today is Free Your Mind, The Rest Will Follow, Mindfulness Practices and Abolition Pedagogy. And next Thursday, we'll launch our bi-weekly book conversation on the text, Love and Rage, The Path of Liberation Through Anger. In our current and social political climate, anger and rage would seem to be two of our most accessible and active and activated emotions. And so SBI is turning to Owen's wisdom to learn practices for befriending our anger. Love and Rage is not a book about bypassing anger to focus on happiness or a roadmap for using spirituality to transform the nature of rage into something else. Instead, it is one that offers a potent vision of anger that acknowledges and honors its power as a vehicle for radical social change and enduring spiritual transformation. Owens pulls together Buddhist philosophy and a wide range of meditative traditions so that we can face our anger and welcome it as a teacher and befriend it so that we can help benefit others and ourselves.
So you are all in for a treat tonight. Dr. Lis Valle, one of our book conversation partners, will lead us in a meditation from Lamarad Owen's book, Love and Rage. And we'll close tonight's program with a word from our book conversation partners, Stacey Williams and Lis Valle. We hope that you'll consider joining us next Thursday. You don't have to read the book before the session. Over the course of 6 bi-weekly sessions, we'll read the book together. And before we say farewell until next Thursday, I will share a bit about our communal healing space.
And so before we get ready to dive into our conversation with Johari, there's just a few housekeeping items. We will be doing a Q&A session. And so we invite you to please submit your questions in the chat box. And we are also live streaming on Facebook. And so if you'd like to host a watch party, please feel free to do so. And I think that we are now ready to get started, Grace.
Yes, we are. So I'd like to invite Lis to lead us in our meditation.
Thank you. Thank you, Grace. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for being here tonight. The brief grounding exercise that we're going to be doing now comes from the book, Love and Rage. And we are going to focus on our breathing before we begin the core of the exercise. We first need to clear our space. So you already picked up a space in which you want to focus on what we are doing, but we want to make sure that now you take us a few seconds to look around and remove any objects or distractions that may impede you to do this exercise, to really focus on meditating at this moment. We're gonna do this for only like a few minutes, 4 minutes or so. So make sure that you are now in a quiet space. If you are listening to something else that is not this, like if you have background music, turn it down or shut it off for the 4 minutes we're gonna be doing this. Clear the space also of the things that are distracting you. For example, put the phone aside, make sure that it's on silent mode or vibration and put it like far away from you that you cannot reach it until you're done with the exercise. And try to focus on this moment here and now. So you can also not only clear your physical space, but also your mental space. Continue by bringing your attention to your breathing. Start breathing in and through the nose. Slowly begin to elongate both the inhale and the exhale, making them very long and deep. Try to relax. Inhale. Exhale. Try to relax. Inhale. Keep your attention on the breath. Exhale. Inhale. As other thoughts come up, keep your attention on your breathing. Exhale and use your attention and your breathing to ground your attention. Inhale. Exhale. Now we are going to switch to inhale through our nose and exhaling through our mouth. Get rid of all the air you have inside and inhale out through the mouth. In through the nose. Out through the mouth. Keep your attention on your breathing. Inhale. Exhale through your mouth. Let's begin a couple more. Inhale. Exhale. Let's do a cleansing breath. We're gonna notice our breathing. We're gonna be doing it through, in through the nose and out through the mouth. And then, but when we do out through the mouth, we're gonna do it like very like deeply, like from the bottom of our hearts with all the force that we can get it out. And we're gonna imagine that we're getting out with that air. We're letting everything that is discomforting out. Everything that is distracting us out. So let's inhale. Forcefully, forcibly breathe out, imagining that you're releasing all discomfort. Breathe in. Breathe out. And one more time. And we're gonna transition back to our space. And as we transition out of being breathing deeply, we are gonna stretch, shake it off, stretch your arms, stretch your face. Shake it off again and rest. And stay in this resting space within you as we move to the next conversation and to the teaching of the night. Thank you for participating.
Thank you, Lis. That was wonderful. I felt like I let out all of my nervousness. So thank you for getting us centered and grounded for our conversation tonight. Welcome, Johari.
Thank you.
Thank you for accepting the invitation to join us this evening. I am so excited to engage with you in this conversation. And I also want to just, a quick note is that, you know, it's not lost on me that we are also in Black History Month. Yeah. And I don't know if you remember, so I've been thinking a lot about Black History Month in this conversation that we're going to have. I don't know if you recall, which I'm sure you do, the conversation that you led for the Office of Community Engagement around Lorraine Hansberry's text, A Raisin in the Sun.
Oh yeah.
It was a delightful time for myself. And it was also a time where I got very curious about Lorraine Hansberry and her life. And I watched a documentary, and the part of the documentary talked about her father, Carl Augustus Hansberry. Yeah. And in there, he talked, he was a political activist and did a lot of work around like redlining, ran for office, and several years of just failed, like disappointment, the recipient of racialized violence, he decided that they were going to leave the U.S. and wanted to move to Mexico. Mm-hmm. So they went to go visit. And while he was there, he had a brain aneurysm and mm-hmm. he died. And I remember thinking to myself, like, is this what happens when Black people and people of color in the struggle for liberation slow down and seek rest? And at that time, I was also recovering from severe burnout and had some physical illnesses that were a result of that. And I just remember walking away from that entire moment, thinking to myself that I have to find ways to both honor and nurture my commitments to justice and Black liberation while also honoring and nurturing the commitments to the body that God gave me. And this is a critical conversation, as you know, in movement work. I've seen so many activists and healers talking about the necessity to slow down. And so as we are having this conversation during Black History Month, we are also celebrating the ways that Black people love on themselves and community in the midst of racialized violence, systemic oppression, racism and oppression. And so Johari, your work is brilliant because you are integrating mindfulness and pedagogy in this movement for prison abolition. And so I'd love for us just to start with you maybe sharing a little bit about yourself, mm-hmm. how you became intrigued with mindfulness and what was your journey to teaching in a carceral setting?
Thank you. It's really good to be here, and hello to everybody. I'll say that, you know, I'm from St. Louis, and I was raised and shaped by a community of Black working class folk who were militant workers, unionized workers, and in particular, there were two institutions that I think bring me to practice of mindfulness, which for me personally comes out of my own path as a contemplative. So in St. Louis, I went to these public schools that were led by Black women who established a kind of Black radical education project. And it was the sense, you know, St. Louis has a kind of violent, I think, you know, all of segregation, right, has a violence, but there's a particular kind of tradition going back to the 19th century with Dred and Harriet Scott, right, of violence and segregation. And so it was the sense in the public school system that, okay, you know, these folks don't want to go to school with us, so we'll make our own curriculum. And so they made a kind of curriculum of a Black cultural nationalism. So I learned, like, in fifth or sixth grade about slave revolts. And there was a constant Black consciousness in all of the classes. So I encountered that very early. And I was really struck by, like, Nat Turner as a kind of mystic because of the way my sixth grade teacher taught it to us, right? So the public school institution was a kind of Black radical education project that nurtured a curiosity for me. And then in addition to that was the church I grew up in, which was a church of Black working class Baptists who brought the culture of the blues, you know, into the space. It was a very queer space. And they provided for me a materialist engagement with the gospel. Mm-hmm. By which I mean, for example, this lyric in a song that says, if religion was a thing that money could buy, the rich would live and the poor would die. Now, when you hear a lyric like that coming from people who, you know, who had to quit school as my grandmother did, who had to quit school at the sixth grade to work in the fields as a sharecropper, I came to really understand, quote, the God of the oppressed, but also a critique of upward mobility that is often merged with the gospel. So that working class Black Baptist community of faith also delivers me, you know, through a kind of perennial grace to this work around abolition. And quite frankly, I was a student of the Black radical tradition before I knew what that was.
And so the seeds have been birthed in you, been planted long before. And so as you've gotten older, you've nurtured those. So can you tell us a little bit about how you got your, how did you find your way into doing teaching in a carceral setting?
I have some beautiful colleagues at UIC who are also abolitionists. And also I had felt drawn to that work, to being present in that work. And so it happened, you know, after the tenure process, it happened quite organically, you know, that I taught a couple of years ago, I taught a class on African Americans in the Civil War. And that is really the frame of my first book, Conjuring Freedom. And so those pieces came together, but I had been drawn to abolitionist work for a question about, you know, how do we live with ourselves, you know, with this cultural or carceral logic. Right. So, um, So rather than let it just be a critique or a question, you know, I'm inclined to do something. And so, Professor Beth Ritchie, who works with PNAP, I spoke to her about it and she said, okay. And so that's how I ended up teaching at Stateville.
How do you define abolition?
So I take my working definition, and I do mean literally working, definition from the Black feminists, specifically Ruthie Gilmore and Angela Davis. And so I define it as a presence and practice of ending the prison system. And I am especially interested in the pulling down of a kind of stronghold that is the carceral logic. Mm-hmm. But as someone who is committed to education, you know, the root word is educare. And so my work as an educator in that space is a work of solidarity. Mm-hmm. And the little paper that I shared with you from a conference I attended, that's what I'm working on now, is writing a publication about, you know, abolitionist pedagogy, which for me is pedagogy of accompaniment. I'm there as an accompanying partner in the process of the folks, you know, in that space.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're on a learning journey together.
That's right. That's absolutely right. Yep. Yeah.
So your paper, I read it. It was brilliant, excellent. And so I want to, can I read a little bit here and ask you to engage some of this?
You can, but it is a panel paper, so
it has a lot of nuggets.
All right, go for it.
So you write this in your section where you're talking about critical justice and abolition pedagogy of mindfulness.
Yeah.
You say, as we work to dismantle the structures and institutions of domination and profit that uphold injustice, how do we attend to fairness, equity, and justice between our learning and teaching partners? How do we struggle with those who aim to teach? This is an important question for those of us who work in institutions that reward us for creating scholarship and activism where we write ourselves out of solidarity. I propose critical justice as a continuation of the social justice tradition, but critical justice calls us to always reflect on our personal, political, and professional relationships. Wow. Can you elaborate on critical justice and how does it show up for you as an act of solidarity in the classroom?
So critical justice is an idea. I, in fact, I have a picture of my grandparents and a candle. I try to live in a way that I'm always accountable to these folks and the sort of ethical and moral lessons that they gave me. And so in this materialist engagement with the gospel is a mandate of social justice, but I wanted to find a language that raised the question in terms of how I work for an institution that sometimes I see producing ideas while at the same time distancing itself from the suffering people who are behind those ideas. And so critical justice is very much about a more reflexive relationship to the social relations of power, right? Because as we know, you know, in this society, things get commodified very quickly, right? I mean, you know, we have such a theater of punditry and a kind of public performance of speech, but I draw from Karl Marx that the point is not merely to interpret the world, but to change it. So critical justice is about, even in the classroom with my undergraduates, right? I mean, in the pandemic, I've realized that I still have to work on decolonizing my pedagogy, right? I don't know that I would have seen it as clearly as I do in this space, but I arrive in these spaces as also someone who's curious. And I can tell you that really trips undergraduates up sometimes, you know, because, you know, I mean, the whole point is this sort of upward, top-down way of approaching everything. And so when they're not hit with, here's what you need to do, or with one of the things that I'm getting at with talking about pedagogy is, you know, you're not the grade, right? Everybody in the room is brilliant. Everybody in the room is beautiful. I just want you to use that big, beautiful brain, you know, to give us all life. So it's that way of trying to create a more democratic way of learning about ideas and processing ideas. Because it doesn't have to, you know, this carceral logic that drives, you know, there are people who deserve and then there are people who do not deserve, right? And it is lurking in, you know, in every institutional ethos in everything that we do. We don't really acknowledge it because we think it's normal, right? I mean, and the whole point is to get more people at the top. And so writing about pedagogy, I'm trying to wrestle and disentangle that logic, because that's also a part of this prison. You know, it is a pervasive logic that we live with.
Absolutely. And you're giving them agency in the classroom setting in a carceral institution that restricts agency. Allowing them to have voice in that space. So can you just share a couple of ways, like in your essay, you also talk about the role that music has played in inspiring this pedagogy. And so can you give some examples of how it shows up in the classroom? Like, what are some of the students' responses to the way that you...
Well, I'm not able to use the kind of clips of music, you know, that I do at UIC. I'm not able to do that in the carceral space, unfortunately. But I try to, I am a musician. And so I try to cultivate a climate of listening, right? And that's the key element of music that I'm trying to work with is, you know, what does it mean for all of us to have a voice and to think of ourselves as a gospel choir, mm-hmm. you know, as an ensemble, where you know, our excellence depends on you willing to participate at your highest level. So it's more that sort of template of music that I'm trying to do, but in the undergraduate classroom, I use music as an invocation. Because I want, you know, and that's why I asked if we could listen to Nina Simone's Come Ye, because I want the classroom to be a kind of sanctuary, right? A safe and holy space for people, you know, to feel that they can take the risk to ask questions and engage. You know, and I'm less interested in the right answer and the wrong. I'm less interested in that. I'm interested in the abolitionist sense, presence.
That's powerful. Like, who are you, right? Getting to know and seeing your students for who they are and inviting them to be a part of that process. Can you talk a little bit about, I want to just talk a little bit about mindfulness. Yeah. Because in your essay, you talk about how mindfulness is a technique to foster healing and harmony. Yeah. So how do you define mindfulness and how does it show up in the classroom?
So the working definition I use is mindfulness is the embodied path of silence, stillness, observation, and awareness. And what I do, or what I am intending when I am present with the work I do in prisons again, is to combine a reading and discussion with a guided meditation. So if you notice, the course I am teaching for Cook County is called The Beloved Community. So what mindfulness for me as the assigned instructor, it involves curating the syllabus in such a way that allows folks I'm working with a kind of space to contemplate ideas, right? I don't want to transport the same kind of empirical right wrong answer kind of ways. I don't want to do that because there is something greater at stake, you know, in abolitionist work. So that is a very conscious decision, is to call a class that's being taught in a prison the beloved community, because I want them to know you too. Yeah, you're in this beloved community with us. You know, the logic of the carceral state is that it's okay for our family members to just go missing. Right? And they'll go missing so quickly and so easily, we'll put them away in a place that you can hardly get to, right? And so so what mindfulness involves is first of all, the work that I have to do, but also creating a body of reading and engagement that allows the folks I'm working with to go deep. I'm grateful for all of the robust prison education projects, right, that are giving folks degrees. I'm all for it, but I'm also interested in a kind of love, a revolutionary love, where I'm committed to people's process of becoming, right? So what kind of people can you be if your mind is not colonized, if your mind is not captive of the triggers of the carceral logic? And so a practice that allows you to steel yourself and to reflect on, you know, we're not the thoughts we have. We have a lot of thoughts, and to really sit with, well, you know, who or what's on the other side of these thoughts? You know, these scripts and narratives. So it is mindfulness for the population, Jia, that we are advocating for, has to do with giving people the tools to enable their process of becoming. It's a kind of love. It's a kind of revolutionary love.
Absolutely. And it reminds me of something that I read in an article regarding the course that you taught at for the Prison Neighborhood Project, the mindfulness course, how one of the students had actually asked for this mindfulness course. Can you share some about that?
Well, yeah. So at the end of the class on Black folks in the Civil War, you know, I asked the folks, well, you know, what other kind of classes would you all be interested in? And I asked my undergraduates the same question. You know, I know that's like, well, you know, you're supposed to know everything and determine it for them, but, you know, these are people. So they kept talking about the nature of the space and the violence of the space, you know, the way that it's, you know, classic Foucault, discipline and punish, right? And what that does to the psyche. And so I listened for a while and I said, you know, this sounds like to me a class on mindfulness. And you know, someone said, well, what is that? And I talked about, you know, and it was an opportunity for me too to be transparent, because one of the things that, you know, I share with young clergy and teachers, the young public school teachers that I mentor, is that there is a way in which your work can take on a particular life of grace if you always understand that those you're trying to serve, that it is the sense that, you know, I'm broke, I know brokenness too. You know, and so so I shared with the students, you know, I've been seeing a spiritual director for a few years, and he's been really nurturing around my contemplative, you know, walk and mindfulness. And so I said, well, you know, I'll talk to some folks and see if I can't offer that as a class. And many folks from that class, from that Civil War class, were enrolled, you know, in it. And it's a joy, right? Because one of the things, the first time I visited Stateville, it's heartbreaking to see that much Black beauty. Right. And it's heartbreaking. And so So this work on the beloved community is intentional about making these folks part of that.
Absolutely. So I know that you, the mindfulness course came about, you had planned on doing it before COVID and then COVID hit.
Yeah.
Yep. So what was it like doing this mindfulness course and trying to create beloved community through a correspondence course during COVID?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it turned out for them. I mean, I don't like remote teaching and working at Stateville, they don't have access to technology in that way. And they were on 24-hour lockdown. But what they had was this reading. And so, you know, that was something to get folks through in, you know, isolation. So it ended up being a very important tool for some folks, right? And I couldn't have foreseen that. I mean, I was sort of bummed out because I was really looking forward to, you know, being with them. I love being with them. And so, you know, there's a part of me that, you know, the loss of the physical classroom, you know, enabled a kind of grief. And part of what the gift of mindfulness is that it opens for gratitude, right? And so, you know, this is not just about Johari and Johari's class, it's not about that, right? It's so some greater thing came out of, you know, that folks had something to read and to actually reflect. You know, it wasn't going to be, you know, they weren't going to get some exam. And I know folks are committed to that and that's going to be there. But I think there is another mechanism of healing and harmony that is allowed when people have the tools to engage in their own self-healing, right? So it ended up being a good thing that they had stuff to read.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, it reminds me a lot of just Bell Hooks' work, you know, that having a social analysis and being able to critique all of these areas of intersecting oppression, it's we need that, right? But we also need it to do something. We need it to heal us. It has to have some sort of end. And so I love what you're saying. I feel like what I'm hearing you also say is that it's a both and.
Right.
You know, like there's room for us to have credentials because people need these material pieces of paper that will give you access in the public space, right? But it also needs to do something for you in ways that are transformative for yourself. And so it sounds like you're creating space for both of those things to coexist.
Yeah, I'm not, even though I'm critical of a kind of stance for, you know, teaching in prison, a kind of what I see as the kind of mission model of colonial Christianity, right? And we have to be mindful of the sort of, you know, penitence, you know, that drove the penitentiary. You know, these are logics, they are theologics, sociologics, these are all ways of perceiving and interpreting people as problems and not the conditions that make the problem. And so I am mindful that, you know, that there can be the wrong approach to teaching in the prisons that, you know, that mirrors this sort of ministry of these are lesser people and oh, I'm so good because I'm doing this, you know, and those folks are really gifted at things, let me say.
You're right on. You're right on. We had a student, and I talk about this often, a student literally asked us, like, what is your end goal? You know, are you here to make model inmates? You know, and because that's been his experience, right? Like that is coming from a place. Yeah. And what he's, and his, what he said is like, you know, being in these courses and taking these classes, it's changed my life. Mm-hmm. You know, we've heard students talk about, I've had a better education in pretrial detention than I did in the 4 years that I was in high school. And so there's something fundamentally wrong with that scenario, you know? And I think it just goes to the point that you were saying is that like education is transformative just in virtue of itself, right? When you allow it to be that, learning is transformative. And so we don't need to come into these spaces with a mission to, to other somebody, right? Because the learning process will just do what it does. And so, yes. We could probably talk about this for a very long time, Johari, but I would love for you to share a little bit about how, because you're the mindfulness course that you taught at Stateville, you're adapting it some for the course that you're doing at Cook County. And you're using the text also that, you know, we'll be going through the OWNS text. So tell us a little bit about what's in store for the students at the jail with your course.
Well, so, I mean, this is always for me a both and, as you just said. So like the first thing we're reading a selection from Dr. King's Strength to Love, because I never want to do, you know, a disservice to his vision of the beloved community. So we're reading a chapter from that, and then we're reading Baldwin's The Fire Next Time. So we're engaging ways in which folks, Black folks, have talked about love, you know, not simply as emotion and feeling, but as a social, political, radical project in the world. And so we're starting with that and then going into Owen's text, you know, about self-healing and reflection. So it's both, and we have the tools of analysis. We're reading Angela Davis's Are Prisons Obsolete, you know, so that we have an abolitionist text. Because I think that is important for the folks we're working with. I don't think we should be calling ourselves abolitionists and the students we're working with have no idea what, you know, how we understand that. And what I have learned from the folks that I've worked with is understanding when they see in me and hear from me that I don't think that stuff is normal and necessary, that opens them up in a particular way, that they trust the work you do with them in a particular way. So, they're in store for all of that, you know, a really, you know, rigorous reflection on, well, what is love? And have you ever thought about what that means? And, you know, I'm trying to inspire little love cells, even in that space, right? Little communes of love, you know, what it's a radical vision. But if folks are open, you know, to sort of going there, in that, because we can't wait, you know, it's the time is always now. So that's what they can expect is, you know, and I'm looking forward to reading their responses and engaging them in ways and listening to their questions. So that's what they can expect, you know, is some fire.
Yeah, it's gonna be a great course. And we'll wrap up here and I just have one last question for you, and then we'll turn it over to some Q&A. You will be coming back in a few weeks to lead us in a mindfulness practice. Mm-hmm. Can you share folks who are listening here with us today what's gonna be like?
Yeah, so you've probably figured out by now, as I said, I go these Black working class Baptists and those gospel blues. That's the source of pretty much everything I do. So as a student of mindfulness and trying to think about how to craft a healing and harmony project for our folks, right? For Black folk. And I teach everybody's child, but I have, you know, I have a special attention to Black children because the society seems to hate them so. But in trying to think about our folks, you know, what are the tools in our cultural toolbox that I can use? And in thinking about listening and silence. And so the title of my little workshop is In My Solitude, Lady Day and the Black Contemplative Tradition. And we are going to listen to some Billie Holiday and listen to how meditative her music can be to talk, you know, using that as a container for what does it mean for us to sit and attend to ourselves, right? to acknowledge these thoughts, but to understand that that's what they are, their thoughts, and that the mind, you know, leans toward creating in order to cling. But in my solitude, right? What is the pure consciousness, right? That can only be reckoned when we remove the noise. So we'll be doing, this is a workshop where, you know, we'll do some listening to each other, learning how to listen and listen in order to learn. That's the sort of premise.
I love it. We are in for a treat. And so we will share information for folks to be able to register for that mindfulness session with you. So thank you. And so now, thank you, Johari, for this time and conversation. And I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Grace, and she will lead us in the Q&A section.
Yes, thank you, Jia and Johari, for this conversation. Before we get into the Q&A, I wrote down a quote that you said, Johari, that really stuck out to me. Heartbreaking to see that much Black beauty imprisoned. And so I'll be carrying that quote with me after our session today. So if anyone has any questions, they can put them in the chat or in the Q&A, but we will start with this one. So someone asked if you can restate your definition of mindfulness because they thought it was great. And so they want you to restate it for them.
Yes, sure. Mindfulness is the embodied path of silence, stillness, consciousness, and awareness. I might have said observation in place of consciousness, but it is very key in, you know, how I study mindfulness, that it's embodied, because in many respects, so, you know, I chose free your mind just as a catch, you know, for this time together. But one of the reasons I'm attendant to this notion of the mind-body split is because, as somebody who is a student of the Black radical tradition, the Africans who came here did not arrive with that separation of the mind and the body and the soul and all that compartmentalization. That is actually not true to a Black epistemology. And so working with mindfulness is not about separating, you know, the mind from the body. No, it is an embodied path where it is one integration of existence.
Yes, thank you. Can you say a little bit more, in your conversation with Jia, talked a lot about carceral logic. So if you can just put some language to what carceral logic is and kind of how that is formed.
So, you know, I think the carceral logic is the product of the nexus of race, capitalism, empire, and patriarchy. That nexus produces a carceral logic, right? That some people just deserve. Some people deserve to be incarcerated because they are this particular kind of person. And what is missing is the social engineering of criminality and poverty and miseducation, right? That's a part of a logic, a way of reasoning and justifying a nationalized system of carceration as something normal, right? And the reason I'm sort of hard about it is, you know, who are we as a society that we can't imagine being alive without millions of people being punished and tortured? So the carceral logic, you know, born out of that nexus of race, patriarchy, empire, right, and capitalism, that nexus, right? I mean, it's not accidental that profit is a part of the problem, right? and scarcity, right? And so, you know, when people, well, you know, what are you going to do if we don't have this, that, and the other? And I'm like, yeah, you could take some money from war. You could, I mean, you know, so yeah, that's how I describe the carceral logic.
Thank you. And so another question was that surrounding how many Americans are captive to the carceral system and the kind of quote unquote benefits. So how do you prepare your students both in and outside of the system to begin to rethink those systems and its use or benefits? And also, how do you begin that process of acknowledging the harm of the penal system?
Well, it varies from class to class. You know, one of the things, and I know someone put in the chat about me mentioning about decolonizing my my pedagogy. One of the things that when I am able to return to face-to-face teaching, I hope and I feel that I will be a better listener. And I am already not a teacher who does all the talking, you know, but a deeper listener, right? And so in part, because so much of my teaching is studying this tradition in which these Africans who are coming from diverse tribes, ethnicities, and languages, they forge a Black community right in the bottom of those ships, on those plantations in the slave quarters. They form collectives. And so by doing so, they call into question the ethics of profit, of exploitation, and of the carceral reality itself. And I teach a lot about the 19th century, and it's never, you know, students are sort of like, every time I teach this, when, you know, we get to Reconstruction, and, you know, the plantation replaces slavery, the sharecropping, right, does, and convict leasing. So all of these forms of a kind of racialized capitalism are created in order to replace the former slave system. And so when, you know, when you open that, you know, students are like, wow, really? That's yeah, you know. So it's really in the teaching of history that I'm able to do the kind of intervention that you mentioned. And I have to push further, because if I'm thinking about critical justice, the question is, you know, where are your feet in relationship to your critique? So, you know, there is plenty of really smart and sexy punditry on TV where folks break stuff down and you know, but how do you live in relation to power? That's the question.
Yeah, and kind of even following that train of thought, there's a question here. So when we think about power and we think about how power is top down and how it kind of infiltrates every part of our society. So would you define incarceration as bigger than just jails and prison? For example, carceral logic being fully present in how we segregate our communities and how some people are deserving of safety and others are not.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, I think it is a logic that resides in churches. Right. And the way that a theology around, you know, like I've heard in sort of some gospel songs, you know, so-and-so is the head and not the tail and I'm in front. It's like, really? You know, you think that the Christ is, you know, doing that. Right. And so it's in the very sort of popular culture of music and even sometimes sermonizing. So oddly, I think it's in that space. The presence of police in schools, you know, that is a sort of very obvious point of the carceral logic, that especially Black and brown children need to be policed, not just policed, but they need to be body slammed, right? And so I don't actually see places where it doesn't exist. I mean, that kind of violence is so pervasive and we are so used to it. But Grace, I want to say something about that very thing, right? Is because what it means to engage a carceral population, it also means that I use mindfulness as a way to attend to nonviolence, right? Because violence is a part of the carceral process. And it's a part of the very maintenance on the day to day. And so what a practice of mindfulness does is to engage in your mind as a space of nonviolence.
Yeah, thank you. So how difficult would you say that it is to help students embrace the learning opportunities within the jails, as opposed to dwell on the punishment that they are experiencing in that time?
Say again?
Like, how difficult is it to help the students embrace the learning opportunities as you're teaching in the jails and in the prisons, mm-hmm. As opposed to dwelling on the punishment that they're experiencing? Do you find that that's difficult, or are they really open to engaging in that learning with you?
Yeah, I find a more openness. I tell you, the last time I taught at Stateville, the class started at 6 a.m. Folk were, you know, there, and they had read and they had, you know, engaged. I mean, I think the failure of schooling is part of the experience of many of the carceral folks that I work with. They remark about, you know, at a point, just the way their sort of mind and intelligence is dismissed, you know, by teachers. And what I write about in this paper that I'm developing is that there's a way in which people are rewarded to do that. You know, you pluck out the students of color that, you know, white folks approve of, right? And you sort of damage the other students. And so there's a way in which this is more pernicious than is often imagined. And so I find these students very open. And they have a lot to say, you know, about class, you know, a lot to say about things that, you know, are not polite to, you know, to for them to say in other contexts, I know, right? Because they see, you know, they see even the sort of machinations of Black politicians from a particular angle. So yeah, they're not at all, you know, I don't need to go there to wake the children sleeping. They're pretty woke already.
Thank you. So another question that we've had is, where do you start to get incarcerated Black men to understand their need to decolonize their minds toward mm-hmm. undoing their condition and move towards healing?
Yeah, I will say that, wow, that's such a great question. And I will say that, that, you know, at Stateville, it's a class of all men, not all Black men. I think I had, you know, a couple of Latinx brothers in there and a couple of white dudes, but attending to the question of Black masculinity, especially in that space, that's not easy, right? Because again, what I'm trying to do with mindfulness is make that a path to think about that particular idea of a toxic and violent masculinity. And I'm always mindful that what we're trying to do around that topic is the complete opposite, you know, of the prison guards. You know, it's such a sort of plantation ideology, you know, and the prison guards are the sort of drivers. It's just disastrous. But I don't have a quick answer to like how to do that. But fortunately, you know, in any class I teach, I do foreground a kind of intersectionality. So, you know, masculinity and those topics around gender, those are a part of what I'm going to do. I always know that I don't determine, you know, people's reactions, and their people do have reactions, but I think the reactions are good. You know, what I would say as a mindfulness student is, okay, let's pay attention to that. What's the trigger there?
So you mentioned a revolution of love.
Yeah.
So what does the community within and outside, what role do they play in that revolution?
Well, in part, changing our relationship to the people, right? Incarcerated, changing our relationship to that. And again, you know, in the education spaces, in the church, this notion where, you know, just some folks just, you know, they just don't, that sense of unworthiness is so deep for many folks. And it is not just the folks in that space, it's that sense of unworthiness that actually leads to many of the criminalizing acts that take people into that space. So one of the things, Grace, I would say is understanding, and this is why the class has the title that it does, understanding that these folks are a part of our beloved community. And from there, demand that people be treated like human beings as we dismantle it, right? Because it's irredeemable.
Yeah, so Jia, in your discussion with Jia, you guys were talking about this kind of balance of both and. And so when we're thinking about abolition as something that is creating something new, right? Mm-hmm. How do we, what would your kind of definition of justice be when we think about kind of balancing wanting to bring humanity to incarcerated folk and also wanting justice for ills such as murder and things of that nature? So what is your definition of justice, and how do we balance those things in the both and?
Well, I'm more in the camp of restorative justice. You know, that off the bat, that is what interests me is you know, how do we engage in accountability, right? And that accountability involving restoration, restoring the community. It would mean a radical departure from a notion of justice that's tied to death. Right? Think about it. It's like, really? But that's exactly, you know, what we're dealing with. It means, you know, and Jia knows this is not a secret. You know, one of the things I want to commit to on the other side of this is a kind of faith and abolition network. Because I think our faith communities and whatever they are, they have a lot to offer, right? And one of the things, though, that I know we have to do as a part of a kind of decolonizing process is question, why do we think we absolutely need this punitive God? You know, why are we convinced that, you know, that God blesses the rich with more, and, you know, the poor with less, and why, you know, why are we trained in ways that that deal so symptomatically with the ills of society? And I mean, it is like a panic, you know, we avoid the root. And so these logics, they are really, you know, in the words of Apostle Paul, we have to engage in the pulling down of strongholds. And that means our institutions would look radically different. Yes. But, yes. You know, but those sort of, that sort of bourgeois norm of what, you know, what we think we're doing, I think that has to be questioned.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have to begin to look at how we change from this punitive soteriology and view on salvation, and like move more towards a soteriology of restoration and grace. And
thank you. And the thing is, Grace, is that sort of punitive punishment, it's a Calvinist theology that was a part of the settler colonialist mindset of Puritans and Pilgrims to begin with. Mm-hmm. And we have not become a better society because of it. So, you know, as you know, this is a challenge to empire.
So we have a question about, do you think that we are at a point and at a critical moment of change?
Well, I think we always are. I think there, nothing can be wasted. And I think, you know, God wastes nothing. And I think we always are. I think, you know, as I hearing that question, it just reminds me of Walter Benjamin, the Jewish philosopher and mystic, you know, that it is always for the oppressed a state of emergency. Right. And so we are always called to the fierce urgency of now. That is our reality. Which is why we have to be clear about, you know, reform versus abolition. And Angela Davis wrote about this a while ago. But while, you know, there are things that happen at individual prisons that bring relief, it is just not something that is salvageable. It is always now, Grace, and
you said God wastes nothing, and I felt the Holy Spirit. I was like, preach it. So we had a question that was just kind of curious about the age differences in the folks that you teach at the jail.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. Let's see. I think there were folks ranging from early 60s to early 30s. And you know, Stateville is a place where folks have been there a while, or they have been transferred to Pontiac or some other, you know, disgusting dungeon. So yeah, so that's my experience at Stateville, is that it had been early 30s to early 60s.
Yeah, and then also someone's just wondering, how did you come to this work?
So again, I work at UIC in the Department of Black Studies, and there are a couple of abolitionists in my department, in particular, Professor Beth Ritchie. And I'm always hesitant to say folks' names because I know some of the stuff I say, people be like, oh, do you know he's crazy? So I actually had been, in addition to this work, I also, I volunteer teach at a school on the west side of Chicago. And I can see how those material conditions of poverty are engineered to put some of those children in prison. And the way that the police presence is there, you know, to do that very thing. And working in that space really sort of jumped out to me around prisons and the sort of just the irredeemable reality of it, right? If you could do that to children, And I'd been talking to Professor Ritchie about it, and she was really gracious about this, because I don't think if I didn't have tenure, I don't think I would have been able to juggle that work, because it's quite a drive to Stateville, right? Which is intentional, right? It's to just get folks, to make it just unavailable for folks to be connected, right? So, and to make them invisible. So not only have they been snatched, right? But, you know, then we'll make it, but we'll just make them invisible. And I was having these conversations with her. And finally, I just said, you know, I think I should be teaching and doing some kind of work there. And Beth, you know, is really acquainted with my work as a teacher. I said, well, what do you think about a class? You know, I this book just came, what if I did a class on that 19th century, which has, you know, this piece around Reconstruction and convict leasing in it. So that's how, that's, you know, and she's a part of this prison neighborhood arts project that that places folks who do arts and teaching in that context. And that's how logistically I started doing it.
Thank you so much, Johari, for this time. It's been so fruitful. Before we conclude this Q&A section, is there any final words that you'd like to share with us?
Love and abolition.